Earlier this week, the Government Accountability Office issued a report detailing serious and growing drug shortages in the United States. Sabrina Tavernise covered the story for the New York Times, joins us now from Washington. So, first of all, how big of a problem is it? How widespread are these shortages?
So it's actually a fairly serious problem. The number of shortages since 2010, rather 2007, the number of shortages since 2007 have tripled. So, you know, this is anything from injectable cancer drugs to drugs like nitroglycerin that are used in heart surgeries. It's a very, very wide range of drugs and it's presenting some very serious problems for hospitals around the country.
So how did we get here? Is there any particular cause for the shortages?
So it might seem strange, but it's often sort of a mystery when a drug goes into shortage as to why. You'd think that there would be a straight, plain, simple answer, but in many cases there are not. The producers themselves are a bit secretive. They say it's a trade secret to tell the world exactly what's happening that's causing the shortage. So they don't need to detail the reason. Oftentimes, however, it's that there are very few producers of sterile injectable drugs. Those are the drugs that are most often in shortage in the United States. Say 2, 3, 4 producers only, and many of the production lines that they have are quite old. So kind of like an old car needs a lot of repairs, more kind of focus and attention. The same thing with these plants. And when something goes wrong, the FDA steps in and says, well, we can't produce on this line if there's contamination in the drug. And so then what happens, the line is shut down, sometimes even an entire factory, and a drug goes into shortage because the few number of other producers simply aren't in a position to ramp up production quickly enough to keep up.
So are there economic factors that contribute to this?
Yes, very interestingly, there were economic factors. So sterile injectable drugs and generic drugs generally are very, very low margin drugs, a very, very small profit margin. So sometimes what happens is, a line goes down, something breaks down, and a company, a producer looks at the margins and looks at the economics and says, well, it's not really worth, with the margins we're getting on this drug, continuing the line, putting the money in to fix it. So in effect, they let it go into shortage, and even if people, need it, even if it's a critical drug, say, for example, the nitroglycerin in heart surgeries, it's just not, they don't produce it. And at the end of the day, the FDA can encourage, producers to do, to keep going, but doesn't really have the power to force them to do that.
So what are the recommendations by the GAO of what the FDA should be doing?
So what the GAO said essentially was that the FDA needed to be essentially more nimble in how it was predicting these shortages. It has now a tremendous database of numbers that tell it what's in shortage and how long it's been in shortage. So there's a fair amount of data, but basically the GAO said the FDA wasn't using that data to kind of look at overall patterns in the country, look at kind of how these things tended to shake out and then try to predict when the shortages would occur. So that's what the GAO told the FDA they needed to get better at.
All right, Sabrina Tavernise from the New York Times. Thanks so much.
Thanks a lot.